Okay, 10:35. So, hi everyone. Welcome to this first regular session of the day. My name is Michel Schudel. I'm a software developer for a company called Craftsman in the Netherlands. We do all kind of innovative projects at our customers like Rabobank, where I'm situated, for example, but also Dutch IRS. And today I'm going to talk about cryptography. So, thank you everybody for coming. So, first thing is, how to come to this talk. A few years ago, I had to build a crypto toolbox for Rabobank. And I basically said, well, was this necessary for? In Java, it's pretty straightforward. No, it's too hard. So we want to build some API over that. They said, okay, build it. Didn't give it much thought afterwards. But then at the beginning of 1997, I started doing stuff with crypto coins. So anybody still have any crypto coins left? Yeah, a few of you. So how's it going with those crypto coins? So, well, they didn't make me rich. I wouldn't be here. So yeah, not much success there. But I was really interested in, you know, if you go to a crypto coin exchange, you log in using HTTPS, you do some transactions, all stuff like that. And the cryptography underneath this, all this stuff is pretty amazing. So I really dove into that, and I wanted to learn a little bit about this more, because like security, for example, is not something as a Java developer you are really focused on every day. It's like out there, but you know about it, but not too much. And the same for cryptography. So it would be fun to give a session about how cryptography works in Java. So thanks for being here. My battery just died. Okay, no problem. So nothing's happening. Oh. Yeah, okay, so I have to do it like this. So today we're going to talk about cryptography and a basic understanding of cryptographic concepts and how they're done in Java. So what is cryptography? Cryptography is the practice and study of hiding information, and that's all there is to it. So it's been around for a long time as well. So anybody know what this is? The picture on the right? Yeah, Rosetta Stone, yeah. So basically it had Egyptian hieroglyphs, but also some form of demotic scripts, and also Greek, which we could read, which helped us to actually decipher what these hieroglyphs said. So that was a major find. It was found in like 1969 or something like that. So goes back a long way further than that. The Romans used this too. This is the Caesar cipher. So it's basically a simple form of encryption that you say, okay, we shift a few letters in the alphabet, and the garrison I want to send a message to also know that they have to shift a few letters back, and they can decipher the message. So it's really simple. They gave each garrison a different type of shift, but it basically worked. It was a very simple form of cryptography. And you might not have expected this, the Kama Sutra, but in the Kama Sutra, there's a passage about using cipher code and encryption for communication between lovers, actually. So for those of you who thought cryptography wasn't sexy and boring, I prove you wrong, okay? So, and of course, this is very famous. This is the Enigma machine. It was said to have been cracked by Alan Turing and his team, but I was pointed out at a different conference that actually it was cracked already a decade before by some Polish scientists. I didn't know about that. But Alan Turing is the most well-known person for having cracked this message, and it has been said to have shortened the war by like 3 or 4 years. So that's pretty amazing. So what does cryptography actually try to solve? So first, there's the problem of confidentiality. So basically encrypting a piece of data and the other party being able to decrypt it and being the only one who can read it. There's also the concept of integrity. So has the message been tampered with? And last but not least, authenticity. So if I send a message, can I prove actually to the one who receives the message that I'm the one who sent it? So these are things that contemporary cryptography try to solve. So there are three components of cryptography. So there's first a piece of data that is sensitive information that you want to encrypt somehow. And of course, the second part is the algorithm that will encrypt this piece of data to something else. So now, if you only had these two, it wouldn't be much use, because The algorithm is out there, it's open, anybody can read how this works. It's the same as a lock in a bank vault, for example. You can download the specs and see how it works. So you need some piece of information or some concept that will allow you to be the only one to open it. And that's, of course, where keys come in. So you have two types, secret keys and asymmetric keys, public-private keys. We're going to come to this later. And contemporary cryptography basically exists like you could split it up in three parts. So first, there's symmetric encryption, where Bob and Alice want to encrypt and decrypt a message, and they use a key to do this. So this is a secret key they both share. How they get into the possession of this secret key is something else. We're going to come to this later. And asymmetric encryption, where you have a key pair, where, for example, if Bob wants to encrypt a message and send it to Alice, he will encrypt it using Alice's private, Alice's public key. Alice will receive the message, will decrypt it using her private key. So Alice is the only one who has this private key, so she's the only one who can read the message. So this is an example of asymmetric encryption. And another form that another part of cryptography is that's really important, hashing. And it's actually the first one we're going to look at today. So a few things about how this is done in Java. So Java basically implements has two APIs. One is called JCA, Java Cryptography Architecture, and the other one is called Java Cryptography Extension. Now, the basic idea was that the JCA was the API part and the JCE was the implementation part. But throughout the years, this has somehow kind of been mixed. So now we talk about JCA, JCE as part of a whole because it's not really separated anymore. So if you look at the architecture, what you have is a Java application using cryptographic functions. It will send a request to the JCE or JCA API. And then the actual handling of this request will be handled by CSPs or cryptographic service providers. So these are implementations of all the algorithms that the JCA exposes. So now you see three examples here. One is the SunGC. It is included in the JDK. You can use it, no problem. It covers most algorithms. But if you want to do really fancy stuff or complicate or new algorithms, there's an open source library called Bouncy Castle. You can download it on Maven Central or go to this website. And there are other CSPs as well. So for example, you can imagine storing keys in a hardware security store. So there are lots of cryptographic service providers out there. But today we're going to look at SunGC mostly. So if you want to plug in a security provider, there are two ways to do this. You can do it programmatically by accessing the security class in Java, and you can say add provider, and you put in a new class, and it will be registered in the security layer. Or you can register it in the Java security file. So there are already two providers in here. I will add a third one. And the order here is important. So if there's an algorithm that exists both in provider one and provider three, it will take provider one. So if you want to have specific provider three, you have to specify it when you call it. The way of registering in JDK 8 and 9 is a little bit different. So the Java security file in JDK 8 is in a different place than in JDK 9 onwards. You can see the location here. Now, JDK 8 and previous had this library extension mechanism that has been removed from JDK 9 and onwards. So if you want to have a jar with a cryptographic service provider, now you just put it on a class path and be done with it. So before, you had to put it in the lib/ext directory. So for those of you who are still in Java 8, that's the way you should do it. Now, I'm not going to go through this all again because we'll encounter most of this stuff during this talk. But just to give you an indication how big this API is, these are the classes that you mostly will use when using cryptography in Java. So it's not a lot. It's like maybe 8 to 10 classes. And then you can do most of your cryptographic operations with this. So today we're going to cover hashing. We're going to look at symmetric encryption. We're going to look at asymmetric encryption. We're going to look at digital signatures, which are really important. And last but not least, we're going to take a look at certificates. So this is all very introductory stuff. And we're going to cover them one by one. So let's start with hashing. So what is a hash? Basically, a hashing algorithm is taking some piece of data, for example, a piece of plain text. You put it to this algorithm. And mind you, there's no key involved here. And out comes a sequence of bytes called a hash. Now, hashing has a few properties that applies to our algorithms. So the first one is it's one way. For example, we have a text called fox. You put it to a cryptographic hash function. Out comes a digest or hash. And this is basically a checksum or stamp of this input. You cannot reverse it. So you cannot go back from the digest to the original text. Second one is it's deterministic. So if I put the same piece of data through the hash function again, out comes the exact same hash. It's fixed size. So no matter how big your input is, the digest size is always the same. And the last and fourth, it's pseudo-random, which is very important. So if I just change one character here, so there's a character there, a V that's changed to a U, the digest is completely different. So there's no considerable way to predict what this hash is going to look like. So it's really pseudo-random. That's really important. Now, there are a few hashing algorithms that you probably heard of. So MD5 and SHA-1, so these are hashing algorithms. Please don't use them anymore. They've been hacked already. Even if you go to MD5 and you look at MD5 hash on Google, you will get the original text. So you can just look up the reverse on Google now. So don't use them anymore, please. Most cryptographic functions use this one, so SHA-256, which we're going to look in, we're going to examine in a moment. And why is this a good hashing algorithm? It has to do with collisions. So we talk about a collision when you have two pieces of data that are not equal to each other and they produce the same hash. Well, you can imagine this could be a problem in passwords, for example, because you can log in for a user with two different passwords. You still have to find it, of course, but it is a security risk. Now, to give you an example of the chances of this happening, the current Bitcoin hash rate, so Bitcoin calculates this hash over and over again, is now 300 quadrillion hashes per second. So that's quite a lot. The chance of a collision attack, and you have to take my word for this, is if you calculate 2 to the power 128 hashes, you have like a 40 to 50% of finding a collision. Now, how long would you take to actually calculate that many hashes? Well, the time needed at Bitcoin's current rate would take like 4 × 10⁻³⁰ years. So now if you imagine the age of the universe, it's quite smaller than that. So the chance of a collision there happening will be quite slim. Don't worry about this, okay? So how to do this in Java? So Java has a class called MessageDigest, which is part of the JCA. You can ask a static method on that. So the algorithm I want to use, SHA-256, I can put my message in it and out comes a hash. So simple as that. So I'll give you a quick demo of that. Let me put that here. So I have, is this readable in the back? Yeah, thanks. So I have the four text, so the four properties I just mentioned, and I'm gonna write a function here that will calculate a hash. So I'm using live templates because I'm not a very fast typer. So first thing you have to do is create a message digest. So this is a static function. It will give me a digest instance, and then I can throw in the input. So I convert the string to bytes, and I will print out the digest that is the result of that. So I'll run this. Let's see. So it should give me an output window somewhere here. Yeah. So this is one way only. So out comes the digest. Fine. So if I put the exact same text again, out comes the same digest. See, the same as this one. Pseudo-random. So I've changed one letter here. And the digest is completely different, and it's fixed length. So if I put in a lot of data, the digest has the same length. So that's a short demo of the properties of message digests. Now, what are applications of digests? Of course, anybody ever had to store passwords or something like that? Well, probably not. Probably, yeah, maybe. Anyway, you shouldn't be store passwords anyway. You should store the hash, and maybe a salted hash. But a hash is a good application of storing passwords because you can predict how many spaces it will take because the digest is always the same size. Now, interesting one is Bitcoin block mining. So this is a graph projecting the Bitcoin energy consumption relative to several countries. So you can see that right now, like the current energy consumption of Bitcoin is like 90% the total energy requirement of the Czech Republic. So that's quite a lot. So why is this? This has to do with hashing. Because there's something in the specification of Bitcoin that says, if you make a new block for the blockchain of Bitcoin, you should, if I would produce a hash of this block, it should start with a number of zeros. This is in the specification. This has been agreed to by all Bitcoin nodes. So I have four zeros here. It's not a big deal, but still. So what happens is, for example, if I would have a Bitcoin of kudos to conferences, and I would say, okay, I will give JFOL 5 kudos because it's an awesome conference. I would make a transaction and maybe a transaction to DevOx. Yeah, it's a nice conference, but not as nice as this one. So this is a block of transactions. So now I have to calculate a hash, and it should start with four zeros. So I calculate this, and no, it doesn't start with four zeros. So there's a thingy called a nonce here. So I can use this. This is just a number that starts with zero to actually alter the contents of the block. So if I alter only this number, out comes a different hash. So I will increase this nonce. I will calculate the hash again. Nah, doesn't start with four zeros. No good. So I will increase it again. Calculate the hash again. So now it starts with four zeros. Okay, this is a valid block. Now, you can imagine that there's no predictable way to say, okay, just four more or five more and it'll start four zeros. You don't know because it's pseudo-random. You don't know. So, of course, this took me only three tries, but of course, when you mine a Bitcoin block, it will take you a way longer time than that to actually calculate a hash that matches because it has to start with like 32 zero bits or something like that. So this will take a long time, but the reason for the energy consumption of Bitcoin is this hashing algorithm. So that's hashing. There was a simple part. So let's look at semantic encryption. So we have already seen this. So Bob wants to encrypt a message, send it to Alice. She can decrypt it with a key that they both share. And semantic encryption is implemented in blocks. So what does this mean? Semantic encryption doesn't work on all your input data at once. It will just take a sequence of bytes from your input data and calculate a cipher from that. So it works in blocks. So, for example, this is an algorithm that works on, if this is UTF-8, this would be 8 bits. So the block size of this algorithm would be 8 bits. So you put in a conference, for example, JavaZone, and out comes a ciphertext. So this is how semantic encryption works. Now, a note on algorithms. First, there was DES. It was invented by IBM in like 1977, I think. Don't use this anymore. There was a contest in 1997 where people tried to decrypt a message without having the key. So the first try in 1997, it took them like 5 months. In 1998, it took them 3.5 weeks. And in 1999, it took them 3 hours. So don't use this anymore, please. So what you can use is AES, Advanced Encryption Standards, invented by Vincent Rijmen and Joon Dane, two Belgian cryptographers who won a contest, actually, of this. And this has since become an industry standard. So how do you do semantic encryption in Java? Well, you have a class called Key Generator. So again, a static method. And out will come a key generator instance. You can call a method can generate key on that. It will give you a key. So this is a symmetric key. And then you can ask a cipher instance through the method static instance. You initialize this instance with a key. You put through your message and out comes the ciphertext. So a little more complicated than hashing, but still pretty simple to follow. Now, for those of you who were on older sides of Java, you couldn't use big key sizes because you would get like an error message, illegal key size, stuff like that. I had to download this unlimited key strength security jar because basically I think USA didn't allow you to USB key sizes just like that. I don't know the reason for sure. But now if you're on Java 8 update 162 or higher, 9, 10, 11, you don't have to worry about this key strength anymore. So, but for people who are on older versions, you might encounter this. So let's give you a demo of how encryption works. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take you through the code for a moment. So I'm going to generate a piece of text, encrypted piece of text. So I hope this is still readable from the back, maybe a little bit bigger. So you have a key generator that you can use to, you can use a method getInstance to get a key generator instance. You initialize it with a key. You generate a key. I will print out stuff like here, stuff like that. I have some input here, so JFOL string, and I will repeat this 16 times. So this will be a longer piece of text. So you might notice that this is 8 characters. This will be important in a moment. And also repeat, by the way, is new in Java 11. It's really handy. Before that, you have to do a iterate loop and stuff like that. So now you get a cipher. So I say here AES, which is the encryption method, ECB, which is the method how stuff is chained together. I'll explain this. And this is piece of padding because encryption works on blocks of 8, I just told you. So if you have a text that is like 12 bytes long, you have to pad it with a few bytes. So PKCS5 padding does this in a specific way. It appends it with like a few bytes equal to the length of the padding. So I don't need it here because it's exactly 8 characters and 8 bytes. This is UTF-8. So now I'll put the mode in encryption, and I will call a message called do final, which looks a bit obscure, but this is basically the final piece of data that you put into the cipher. There are also update methods you can use to put in more data, and I will print the cipher text. So now the other way around, I initialize the cipher in decrypt mode, and I will put the encrypted output in it, and I will get back the original text, hopefully. So I'll run this. So yeah, this is the input. So JFOL repeated 16 times. The ciphertext is here. And the decoded output is, again, JFOL. So also using the same key. Now, there's one problem here. So if you look at this, do you see anything strange here? Yeah, there's a repetition here. And why is that? That is because this works on blocks. So if you look at electronic copybook, which is this, is it takes a piece of text every time. Oh, this should have been JFOL, but you get the picture. 8 bytes, and it will just take these 8 bytes and repeat it. So there is a pattern here. Now, this might be not really a problem, but for example, if you put through a picture or JPEG, you get something like this. So this is still very much recognizable. This is not secure. So how do we combat this? Well, there's something called cipher block chaining. So basically what happens is you take the same encryption, but now initialize it with a pseudo-random sequence of bytes called a initialization vector, or IV. You put in your plain text, out comes the ciphertext, and you use this ciphertext as a initialization vector for the next piece of data. So basically each block influences the block after that. So if you use this, the picture will be completely obscure. You cannot recognize what was the original data, okay? So semantic encryption works a little bit different in Java. So this is the same, but now you also need a random sequence of bytes. So you can call a class called secure random. It will give you a random sequence of bytes, like 16 bytes, wrapped in an object called an IV parameter spec. You call in the cipher again, and now you put both the key and the initialization vector in the cipher, and the rest is the same. So out comes something, and you put through the message, and out comes the ciphertext. So if I demo this, I have a CBC demo. So now, So now the first part is all the same. I generate a key. And now here's the difference. So I don't say ACB anymore, but I say CBC. So the cipher algorithm will automatically make a CBC algorithm. So now I need a random sequence of bytes. I'm going to use secure random for that. So I can ask, give me the next 16 bytes. I wrap it in an IV parameter spec. And then here I will put the cipher in encrypt mode and say, okay, just encrypt it like I did before and decrypt it again. So if I run this, you will see, hopefully, that the pattern is gone. So yeah, the ciphertext is starts here. And now 36E, yeah, it's not recognizable anymore. So now it's completely, you cannot see any pattern here in it anymore. So please, when you use semantic encryption, don't use ACB, but use CBC. Now, an application for AES would be, of course, encryption in an HTTPS stream, for example. But you can also, for example, so if you have a secure zip file with a password, it uses AES as well. So you have a wallet or a zip file called my encrypted with my password. You can put it through an algorithm called password-based key derivation function SHA-256, and it will basically generate a secret key based on your password. So if you have a secret key, you can use it then to encrypt your data through AES and have a zip file that is secure. Now, the demo is on GitHub, so I'm going to show you in the last slide. There is a demo of this in the project as well, but for time constraints, I'm not going to do it now. So, key exchange. So we talked about secret keys, but how do we transfer this to the other side? So you can put it in the diplomatic mailbox, but I don't recommend that. So these two guys, Martin Hellman and Wilfried Diffie in 1977, invented a real easy way of exchanging secret keys. So this is really, really good. So what they came up with was this. So you have Alice and Bob again here, maybe not the ones you were thinking of, but for example, the example is okay. So Alice and Bob each think of a private number and they will put it through this mod function. So basically, they will calculate another number, which is called public here. They will exchange these numbers. So Alice will send 2 to Bob, and Bob will send 9 to Alice. And everything you see in the yellow cloud is completely open. Anybody can read this, no problem. And they will use this public number together with a private number to calculate a shared secret again. So this is a way to send to calculate shared keys for both parties, which will both be the same, while using an unsecured channel. This is really cool. So now the idea is that there's no considerable way for anyone who is in the cloud to calculate their private keys or their shared secret, because basically with mod there's information loss, because mod 13 will give me the same number for 13, 26, so forth and so forth. So this is a really good way to exchange secret keys. So, of course, this is also an example of asymmetric encryption, because there are two numbers here involved, private and public. So we're going to look at that now. So asymmetric encryption works like this. Bob encrypts something, uses Alice's public key, and Alice decrypts it with a private key. So it's not the other way around, because that would be no use, because Bob would use calculate something with his private key, and anybody could still read it because the public key is still out there. So if you use asymmetric encryption, this is the only way to do it. Now, we already looked at Diffie-Hellman key coherence protocol. So now I think most of you people heard of RSA, Rivas Shamir Edelman, which is a de facto standard asymmetric encryption protocol, which we're going to use, and also ECC, elliptic curve cryptography, which is used by Bitcoin. Now, in Java, now you have to access a key pair generator because you need 2 keys. So out comes a key pair, which has a public and private key. You can get a cipher again using the algorithm RSA in this example. You put in the public key. You encrypt your message, same methods as always. And the other party can instance a cipher as well with a private key, and you can decode the message. So the only difference with semantic encryption is that you have now 2 keys. So I'll show you a demo of that. Where is it? Asymmetric encryption demo. Yeah, I hope this is big enough. So you get a key pair instance, you initialize it with a key size, so 1024 bits, you generate a key pair, and now I have a sequence of bytes, which I will put through a cipher, I will put it in crypt mode here. Oh, this actually had to be public, but for the demo it doesn't really matter. So I put through the text, I will get a encrypted text back, and on the other side, I initialize the Cypher in decrypt mode. I put the other key in this case, the public key. I will put the encrypted text again, and back comes the decoded text. So, I'll only run this. So now you see a private and public key pair. Note that they're not the same size. So the public key is quite smaller. So this has to do with the mathematics behind this. Now, I also have another test, which basically reads the whole of the Lord of the Rings and tries to encrypt it. I'll run this. And it says, data must not be longer than 117 bytes. So, well, this is not good if I want to encrypt something. So the reason for this is that the algorithm is set up in such a way that you need a key size like 4 or 5 times the input data. So you cannot really use asymmetric encryption to encrypt long texts. And it is pretty slow. So what can you use it for? Well, you can use it for agreeing on symmetric keys, which you've already seen. So Diffie-Hellman protocol. You can use it to encrypt or decrypt symmetric keys. Or you can use it for encrypting hashes or message digests. And that's where basically digital signatures come in. So we're going to look at that now. So we have looked at the problem of confidentiality. So how do you encrypt stuff? But we haven't covered the problem of integrity. So has the message been tampered with? So that is the problem digital signatures tries to solve. So for example, if Bob wants to send a message to Alice, it's easy for a man in the middle to go inside and change the message. So now Alice can produce a hash. Bob can produce a hash for his message. He will send it along with the original message. But still, of course, Alice can verify if this hash is the same as the hash of the message. But still, the man in the middle could have changed his hash as well. So alongside the message. So this isn't really protective. So how do we solve this? Well, we solve this by introducing a digital signature. Now, there are two ways to do it. So one using symmetric encryption and the other with asymmetric encryption. An example of symmetric encryption is key hashed message authentication code, or HMAC. HMAC is English, I think. So what happens is the sender builds a message and puts the message through a algorithm called a MAC algorithm. Out comes a sequence of bytes that basically is signed by a secret key. You send the message and the MAC identification code to the other side, and the other side, using the secret key, can recalculate the message, the MAC again. And it's the same as in the message. The message has not been tampered with because it has been signed by the secret key. So this is one way to do it. Let's see. I'm going to skip AMAC for time constraints for now because this is a little bit more interesting. So digital signatures using asymmetric encryption. So Bob has a piece of data. He will calculate a hash of this, and he will sign this hash using his private key. So this is the other way around from asymmetric encryption. He will then take his public key and send it along with the message, for example, in a certificate or just a plain public key. It doesn't really matter. And he will send this message to Alice. So what Alice will do is first validate that the public key actually comes from Bob using a certificate. Now, what Alice will do is take the data and the signature. Alice will calculate the hash of the data again. What hash she should use is written in the certificate. And she will also take the signature, decrypt it using the public key that is contained within the certificate, and out comes the hash again. So if these two match up, you're sure that the message has not been tampered with, because Bob is the only one who could have signed this hash, and the public key belongs to the private key of Bob. So this is a sure way of knowing that the message has not been tampered with. So now, here again, the other way makes no sense, because if Bob had used Alice's public key, and Alice would have checked the digital signature with her private key, basically anyone could have signed this message. So you don't know who the message is from. So in Java, you get a key pair again. And you have a class called signature that you use to make a digital signature. So you put in a private key, you take your message, you call a method called sign, and out comes a small sequence of bytes called a digital signature. On the other hand, the receiving party will access the signature class also, and it will initialize the signature class with a public key pair, with the public key. It will update the signature class with a message, and the signature method verify, which I didn't specify here, but you will see in a moment, says it's okay or not. So if the digital signature matches just a boolean. So I'll show you this really quickly. So it is, let's see, signing demo, yeah. A little bit bigger. So this is all the same as before, get a key pair. So now I have a piece of data and I will go to the signature class to get an algorithm. I will say, okay, I will initialize this algorithm with my private key. I will feed it my data in byte array form and I will sign something and out comes a signature in byte array form. So on the other hand, you need some kind of verification. So the receiving party will take the signature class again. It will put it in verify mode. It will update the data, the original data, so just this one. And it will say, you can call the verify, and it will say if it matches or not. So it's basically really simple. So if we run this, you should see that, is this the one? Yeah. So signature matches true, which is really easy, of course, here because I put in the same piece of data. So now if I had put in another piece of data, the signature would have failed because basically the hash won't match up anymore. So digital signatures is basically the signature class and the key pair generator. So that's really easy to use. So an application of this is signing cryptographic transactions. So for example, in the Bitcoin blockchain, if I want to send a value of 100 bitcoins, well, quite a lot, but just for example, to a node on the blockchain, which is receiving end, Alice would sign her transaction with a private key. She will send along the signature that comes out of that, along with the public key and the transaction into the network. And the network then can then check that the signature algorithm actually matches up, because they will take the signature. And basically say, okay, this message has not been tampered with and the transaction is authenticated. So this is used in cryptographic transactions all over the place. So this is an example of the digital signatures. So last but not least, we're going to look at certificates. So we've looked at confidentiality, integrity, but not authenticity. So how can I prove that I'm actually the owner of this private key? So that's where certificates come in. So basically, a certificate is a wrapper around a public key, which basically states that, okay, I am the owner of this public key. Someone else has checked that I'm actually am who I say I am, and they have signed this certificate with their public key. Because of course, the problem is, okay, this person who has checked me, are they to be trusted? I don't know. So how to obtain a certificate? So if you have a private public key pair, you can use that key pair to create a certificate signing request. So this is basically some information about who you are, and it will send along that information along with your public key, because your private key you don't give to anyone, to someone or a body called Certificate Authority. So this is a trusted party, and they will actually do a background check on you. So this is just going through your passport identification information and checking that you actually are who you say you are. So if they say, yeah, that's okay, that's fine, they will create a certificate for you, which contains your identity information and your public key, and they will sign it with their private key. So that way you are sure, again, that actually the certificate authority actually has checked your identification and not someone else. So why should I trust this certificate authority? Because, yeah, they have a private key, but I don't know who they are. So that's where certificate chains come in. Oh, sorry. I'm going to explain a little bit what is about in a certificate signing request. So these are some common fields. So common name, organization, city, public email address, and public key. So this is all wrapped up in a kind of encoding, and you can send this to the certificate authority for them to sign this, and you get back a certificate. Now, the problem is, how can I trust the certificate authority? Well, they've gone through the same process. So they basically have also been checked out by someone else. And they have also been checked out by someone else. So where does this stop? So there is one at the top, which is called a root certificate authority, and they are implicitly trusted. So everybody just assumes by reputation or someone else or something else that they are to be trusted. They take good care of their own public and private keys. And you can be quite sure that if this root certificate authority is at the basis of all these certificates, you can be quite sure the certificate is okay. So what happens if this root certificate authority is compromised in some way? Well, this actually happened in the Netherlands. So there was a company called DigiNotar. This was around 2007, something-ish. There were a bunch of Iranian hackers, I read, which broke into their systems and stole their private keys. So at that moment, anyone could pretend to be DigiNotar, this root certificate authority, and basically all certificates that were somewhere in the chain of DigiNotar were not to be trusted anymore, because anybody could have checked these certificates, anybody could produce false certificates, and even the company I worked for at the time had to replace all the certificates with, I think, VeriSign at that moment. So yeah, it was quite hard. Of course, they completely lost their reputation and they went bankrupt in like 6 months. So yeah, there was a major security breach. So just to show how brittle the system can be. So that was something about certificates. Now, I showed you a few demos, they're all in memory. So how do you persist stuff like keys? So you have to store them somewhere, right? So that's where the concept of JCA key store comes to mind. So you have a concept, it's basically a small database in file format that you can put in your class path or anything. So you can get an instance of this key store by using a key store type, for example, JKS or something else, PKCS12, which can store symmetric keys as well. And you can operate this by getting keys, storing keys, getting certificates, storing certificates. So this is a way to store your key material. Now, the concept of key store is abstract. It is an API. So you can also use this to, for example, build hardware key stores. So this is a piece of hardware that actually physically stores keys in its secured memory. But the API will still be the same, only the type will be different. So you will have a key store like, for example, HSM, for example, which will actually go to this box. So, but for this, JKS is just a normal file-based key store. Now, getting keys and storing, generating certificates, storing keys can be quite a hassle if you do it in Java. Like getting keys, pretty simple, getting certificates, but if you want to do more difficult operations like generating certificate signing requests, I wouldn't do that in Java if I were you. So there's a nice command line tool called KeyTool, you probably know it, which takes all of these operations for you. So just a few examples. For example, I'm just going to show you. So I hope this is readable from the back as well. So if I want to generate a key pair, for example, I can do this. I can say KeyTool gen key and then the algorithm, so RSA. I put in here self-signed because I don't want to go to the process of having my certificate signed by a certificate authority right now. The name of the key store, a password, which is called password here. I'll specify the validity of the certificate that is to be signed, which is 360 is a bit strange. Normally it's like a year, 365. And I will use a key size of 2048. So now it will ask me for some data because I have to specify who I am. So let's do this. It's called Craftsman. Organization is Craftsman. Utrecht NL. Sure. Yes, this is correct. So silence is golden, so it now has done something. So let's look at what it has actually created. So I will do the list command and see what's actually in this keystore file. So now you can see it contains one entry, namely a private key entry, and a certificate fingerprint, which is basically like a certificate template. So I can use this to create a certificate signing request to send to an authority. So let's clear this up for a moment. So let me check, where is it? Yeah, so there's a command cert request. So it will say, okay, using this alias self-signed. So this is basically like a hash map of key value material. I will want it to generate a certificate signing request for this. So I have to do this. It will give me this. It's, I think, PEM encoded, something like that. And you can use this to send it to a certificate authority. This contains your public key and all the information I just entered in encoded form. Okay. So once I have a certificate, I can access it through, for example, export certificates. So if I put this in an, let's say, an out file. So it's there, and I am in this Michel. So let's look it up for a moment. They modified. Yeah, here it is. So this is actually a certificate. Yeah. So now you see here issued to Michel and issued by Michel. So this is self-signed. So this has no real value in production life. Okay. You would not normally do this, but just to indicate how easy it is from Keto to generate a certificate. So let's go back to the presentation. So yeah, that basically covers everything. So we've looked at hashing for a moment, semantic encryption, asymmetric encryption, digital signatures, and a little bit of certificates. So there's one more thing altogether now. It's basically to show you where all these things come together, and that is in the HTTPS handshake. So this is the sequence diagram of HTTPS. So what basically happens is a client and a server will agree on a set of protocols that they want to use, for example, Diffie-Hellman or RSA. The server will send its certificate to the client. The client will validate the certificate by checking its digital signature. And then the client will think of a random number and it will encrypt it with his public key. So this is asymmetric encryption. The server will encrypt it with its private key. And through an algorithm, they agree on a symmetric key, just like Diffie-Hellman does. So if you have a secret key in both ends, which are always the same in both ends, otherwise it won't work, you can start using AES encryption to transport data. So this is basically in the HTTPS handshake, all these things come together. So this is what I want to talk to you about today. So a basic understanding, just a nice introduction of cryptographic concepts and how they're done in Java. And for time reason, I'm going to skip Q&A for a moment because I have like 2 minutes left. So please come up to me and ask any question you want afterwards. So thank you very much. If you want to play around with the examples, I have created the GitHub project, which contains the examples I showed you and quite a few more. So there's also Bitcoin block mining in there, which is really cool. Please rate my session in the app. And if you want to leave any extra details about, you should improve this or this was really nice, you can also scan this QR code. It will take you to a Google form and you can leave extra info there. So that would be really appreciated. So thank you very much. Hope you enjoyed it and enjoy the rest of JFall.